I'll be reading from Luke 12, 1 through 12. Luke 12, 1 through 12. Meanwhile, when a crowd of many thousands had gathered, so that they were trampling on one another, Jesus began to speak first to his disciples, saying, Be on your guard against the yeast of the Pharisees, which is hypocrisy. There's nothing concealed that will not be disclosed, or hidden that will not be made known. What you have said in the dark will be heard in the daylight, and what you have whispered in the ear in the inner rooms will be proclaimed from the roofs. I tell you, my friends, do not be afraid of those who kill the body and after that can do no more. But I will show you whom you should fear. Fear him who, after your body has been killed, has authority to throw you into hell. Yes, I tell you, fear him. Are not five sparrows sold for two pennies? Yet not one of them is forgotten by God. Indeed, the very hairs of your head are all numbered. Don't be afraid. You're worth more than many sparrows. I tell you, whoever publicly acknowledges me before others, the Son of Man will also acknowledge before the angels of God. But whoever disowns me before the others will be disowned before the angels of God. And everyone who speaks a word against the Son of Man will be forgiven, but anyone who blasphemes against the Holy Spirit will not be forgiven. When you are brought before synagogues, rulers, and authorities, do not worry about how you will defend yourselves or what you will say. For the Holy Spirit will teach you at that time what you should say. Let me pray for you. Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you that you have gathered all of us here and let us worship your name. There are many people who still don't know you, who are not saved yet. Your word alone is the only truth, and because we know that, we can live this life peacefully. I pray for Pastor Anjiki. I pray for a special anointing upon him. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Good morning. Today I'll be sharing God's word from the passage that have been read. This is an event that took place in Iceland in 2013. There are many beautiful canyons in Iceland made by the volcanic activities, and many tourists go there by bus. One day, there was a person who was lost from the tourist group. She didn't show up to the bus even after the meeting time. The bus driver waited for an hour, but she never showed up, so he called the police. A helicopter was sent for the search, and then 50 rescue crews came out to find her. 12 hours later, in fact, they found out that Nobody was lost. So this is what happened. This woman went out to explore the canyons. And she had changed her clothes before going back to the bus. And people who remembered her clothes, the old clothes that she was wearing, they didn't recognize that it was her. So nobody realized that it was her. One of the lieutenants said in an interview, he said, she didn't realize that she was the one everyone was looking for. When she heard someone explaining about her clothes, that's when she finally realized that they were all looking for her. Last week, we looked at the latter part of chapter 11 in Luke. So the Pharisees and Jesus were having an argument. In verse 54 of chapter 11, it says, they were waiting to catch him in something he might say. He said in the book of Luke that he came to look for the lost and to save them. The lost are those who are in need of purpose in life. The lost are without hope. And Jesus came to this earth to look for this kind of person. So that included the ordinary Jewish people, but it also included the Pharisees too. But they didn't have this realization that they were the lost ones. And they ended up killing Jesus, who had come to save them. How tragic is that? When you don't realize that you are the lost one, you don't see the need to be saved. Doesn't matter how many times you hear the gospel, you just don't realize the need to be saved. So today's passage depicts the continued tension between Jesus and the Pharisees. Verse 1 says, a crowd of many thousands had gathered so that they were trampling on one another. It's kind of like a train full of people. People trampling on one another. So many people had gathered in the house to listen to what Jesus might say. So he says, Jesus began to speak first to his disciples. So what's clear here is that Jesus is talking to his disciples, or we can say he's talking to us, Christians. So simply put, Jesus saying, you are going to face troubles in life. So be prepared. There are three main messages here today. First, be careful not to fall into hypocrisy. Jesus warns us against the Pharisees' hypocrisy. The word hypocrisy comes from a word that means the actor wearing a mask. So back back then, actors wore these masks. A mask that is smiling, a mask that is like an angry face. So all these actors were wearing masks. So the Pharisees, on the outside, they invited Jesus to their house and they called him teacher. But in the inside, they opposed him fiercely and besieged him with questions and tried to catch him in something he said. And that's what Jesus calls hypocrisy. And now Jesus is talking to his disciples, and he's teaching them to be careful of the hypocrisy. We have accepted the gospel and have faith in Jesus Christ as our Savior. He has forgiven all our sins. He resurrected from the dead after 3 years. We believe that we will also resurrect from the dead even after we die. So we are full of hope. But if that doesn't show through our actions, through the ways we live, that's hypocrisy too. What about you? Does your hope in Christ revealed through the way you live your life? Are you thankful? Do you show your hope in Christ through the way you live your life? I recently read a book titled 21st Century Samurai, written by Charles Corwin. And he talks about the clans of Nakajimas, the fourth generation Christians. The first generation, Jiro Nakajima, second, Jiro's son, Shinta, who was an officer in the army. The third generation, Shinta's son, Yutaka. And fourth generation, Yutaka's daughter, Junko. So this book focuses on this four generations of Christians. Author Charles Corwin says, from the perspective of an American missionary, are there many of you in this room who are Japanese? We Japanese sometimes think that we all know about Japanese culture well, but sometimes it's important to have the perspective from other people from other countries and how they see the Japanese. So this is how one American missionary saw the Japanese. So he says, Bushido plays a very important role on the kokoro, or the heart of the Japanese. There were samurais back in the time, and Bushido had a huge part on the way they lived their lives. So people living in this current era, we also have this Bushido spirit. The Japanese are earnest and persevering, noted for their self-discipline, the loyalty to and harmony with one another and the society. These are what Bushido taught them. And he says, these teachings of Bushido resemble those of Christianity, shining away from the worldly pleasures, living a noble life, and showing sacrificial love to others. You can find all these things in the Bible. However, there's a limitation to Bushido. That is, there's no absolute being that transcends time and space. Even though the teachings of Bushido are admirable, but there's no absolute being in Bushido. There's no God in Bushido. He continues, if the Japanese with a Bushido spirit or samurai spirit find God and have faith, hope, and love, they will be the ones that will lead us to a better world. How flattering to hear these words. He says, people of Japan, where are the 21st century samurais? They may not publicly evangelize on the street with loud voices or boldly share the gospel to a stranger on a train, but they control people's attention by the way they act and live their lives. They're placed all over the country. Some are pastors or missionaries or company employees, store clerks, lawyers, teachers, professors, researchers, bankers, architects, doctors, nurses, cooks, nuclear power engineers, musicians, artists, designers, accountants, government workers, workers in the field of agriculture and forestry, CEOs, housewives. A 21st century samurais are sacrificing, sacrificially giving themselves to God, serving the society, and not seeking their own benefit. In each field of their career, they're giving all of their body, wisdom, and spirit. They find satisfaction and meaning of life in bearing one another's burdens and sharing the joy of life. This is the way the Japanese can witness to the world. When we live in this way, showing hope and joy of life, that will be a testimony to the people who don't know Christ. So Charles Colwyn is emphatically saying that if the Japanese find God, they can be the true 21st century samurais. So we are called to be the light of the world and the salt of the earth where we are right now. So don't fall into hypocrisy. Show what you have inside you, the hope and faith in Christ. The second point today is fear God, not man. Verse 4 says, I tell you, my friends. So Jesus calls his disciples, or us, friends. There are many kinds of friends. What kind of friends are true friends? Someone defined friendship in this way. True friends are ones who will stand by you even when the whole world abandons you. When we become famous and successful, there will be people calling us friends. But once we lose all we have, everyone leaves, but your true friends. Jesus says in John 15:13, greater love has no one than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends. And Jesus literally sacrificed his life on the cross and showed his love to us. So now it's our turn to sacrifice our lives for him. When we are ready to make that sacrifice for Jesus, that is when we become worthy of being called his friends. So do not be afraid of man, fear God. Jesus says in verse 4, do not be afraid of those who kill the body and after that can do no more. But I will show you whom you should fear. Fear him who after your body has been killed has authority to throw you into hell. Yes, I tell you, fear him. We believe that God or Jesus resurrected from the dead after 3 days. So we know that a person's life doesn't end at death, but continues even after death. God is eternal, and we live in this eternity. To demonstrate how this is so, let's imagine a long rope, a very long rope. Let's say this represents eternity. So how big or how long is our lives compared to this rope, this eternity? Please, let's say you write a dot or line on this rope. Say your life is 70 years, 80 years, 100 years, but it's less than 1 millimeter. So that's how tiny our life is compared to eternity. But we need to remember that how we live our present life determines our heavenly dwelling in eternity. So the Bible is clear that if we make the right choice to believe in God and Jesus, we can live in eternity. But if we fail to accept him in this life, we live in eternal judgment. In verse 6 and 7, Jesus mentions a sparrow and hare. He's concerned about sparrows and hares. Why does God care so much about sparrow? Maybe God loves sparrow yakitori? No. Why does he care about our hare? It doesn't have to do with his peculiar obsessions with our hair. It means this: if God is concerned with small things, then we can be sure that he's concerned with bigger, more important things. What kind of troubles we are in right now, he knows it. He knows everything. And he says to us, depend on me. So the second point again, fear God. Trust me. Don't fear man. The third point is don't close the doors of your heart on the work of the Holy Spirit. Verse 8 says, I tell you, whoever publicly acknowledges me before others, the Son of Man will also acknowledge before the angels of God. This is not only talking about what would happen at the final judgment. But it's talking about this present life. When we share the story of Jesus Christ with other people, Jesus sees that and says to the angels, Hey, look, that is my friend. That is my disciple. I'm so proud of them. Verse 10. And everyone who speaks a word against the Son of Man will be forgiven. But anyone who blasphemes against the Holy Spirit will not be forgiven. The one who blasphemes against the Holy Spirit will not be forgiven. Who would be considered one who blasphemes against the Holy Spirit? So what's the work of the Holy Spirit? The Holy Spirit shows, like, reveals that Jesus is the Savior. He is the Messiah. This Jesus is the one who died on the cross to save you. He's the one. The Holy Spirit is the one who teaches us who Jesus is. He reveals that Jesus is the one who saved us and He is alive today. So if we reject that, reject what the Holy Spirit says about Jesus, that's a blasphemy against the Holy Spirit. Jesus did many signs and miracles, testifying that He is the Messiah. The miracles that only a Savior can do. But some Jews at the time claimed that Jesus was driving out demons by Beelzebub, the prince of demons. So they were blind and they were blaspheming the Holy Spirit. And it's important to read verse 10 in light of verse 11 and 12. When you are persecuted for your faith, having to defend yourself before the Roman authorities, do not fear. The Holy Spirit is with you and for you. He will tell you what you should say. So whatever happens, do not deny Jesus or forfeit your faith. So if you deny Jesus when you are in danger of your body, it's like telling people that having faith in Jesus is not worth risking and sacrificing your life. And that is what Jesus called the sin that blasphemes the Holy Spirit. So when we publicly acknowledge faith in Christ, that tells the people that believing in Jesus is worth risking our lives. In 2015, the Chinese statisticians took a census to investigate the population of Christians in China. This is a government official census. So it happened 3 years ago. The result came that there were over 160 million Christians in China. So it's probably that there are more. But this is the number that they found. If the number keeps growing at the current rate, it is estimated that 30% of the whole population will be Christians in 20 years. There's no precedent for this kind of revival in the 2,000-year history of Christianity. So China is truly having the biggest revival in history. Xi Jinping, president of the People's Republic of China and the Communist Party of China, are greatly concerned about this situation. The fact that there's a growing number of Christians, this is what they're concerned about. So the Chinese government is very concerned about this situation, but the Japanese government is not concerned about the growing number of Christians in Japan, right? The mayor of Utsunomiya is not concerned about the growing number of Christians. But the Chinese government is greatly concerned. So the government is currently trying to enforce a law to keep religions under their control. So now the house churches are facing pressures and trials more than ever. China Aid, this magazine, reported these facts about trials in China, the persecutions in China. In the city of Shinkyo, a church leader invited four people to their house and did a Bible study. And the government came in and arrested them. They were put in prison for the crime of disturbing the social order. Just having a Bible study, that's considered disturbing the social order. So they were put in prison for 3 years. In the city of Ryonesho, this one pastor sold Christian books. He was charged with a fine of about 800,000 to 1,000,000 Japanese yen. In Sekkyosho, the government told the church to take down a cross on their building. The people were arrested, the pastor giving a 14-year prison sentence, and his wife 12 years. Also in Honshu, a church also resisted the order to take down a church cross on the building, and the court ordered a demolition of the entire church building. Despite all these persecutions, the Christians in house churches in China have not given in or blaspheme the Holy Spirit. They are striving in their faith, proclaiming the gospel. So this is God's message. Don't be afraid of man. Listen to the work of the Holy Spirit. So let us be a light of the world and salt of the earth this week. Let us pray. Thank you that we have this Word of God, work of Jesus revealed 2,000 years ago. You said, we are the light of the world, the salt of the earth. Lord, give us strength to be exactly that. Please bless each and every one of us this week. In Jesus' name, I pray. Amen. Let us pray in silence. May the Lord's blessing be upon you all. Amen. Let me make some announcements.